About 2 weeks ago, I was emailing a friend of mine, and in the course of the normal casual conversation that one has with one's friends, I had to type the word minimum. And I realized as I hit the keys for minimum, just how satisfying that was. Try it, get a keyboard, type minimum. And I instantly realized that's the kind of relatable, fun life observation that needs to go straight to Twitter. So I shared that. A lot of people agreed. Some people disagreed. Gave me their own favorite words to type. We'll get to them in a moment. But then one person said something along the lines of, what word would you have to travel the greatest distance between the keys to type it? And I got really obsessed with answering that question and answering it exactly. And it turns out if you want to crack the distances between the keys on a modern keyboard, you have to go right back to our friend here, the typewriter. I should say, if you're not familiar with the 1980s gripping mystery TV series Murder, She Wrote, those opening titles would have been strange and confusing, which they also were, even if you do know about Murder, She Wrote. I should also mention that this video has been sponsored by Private Internet Access. The current deal, if you use my referral link, you're paying just over $2, like $2.08 a month for VPN protection. At the end of the video, I'll talk more about it and you'll see what cheeky website I'm using it to look at this time. Anyway, down to business. My first step was to work out how far apart are all the keys on a keyboard. I figured that's easy. I'll just look up the distances and no. Not that straightforward. Well, first of all, there is a kind of a standard distance. The keys on the keyboard, if you go across, are 19.05 millimeters apart. That's either center to center or edge to edge, same thing. And the rows are also 19.05 millimeters above and below each other. And it doesn't look like it, but it is the same distance when you go up and down. But then you realize, wait a minute, the rows are weirdly offset from each other. So if you ask people, they will say, yeah, the rows are offset from each other, and they'll give you some explanation. Oh, it's probably so it's easier for your fingers to go between them. But no, it's not. And the offset changes. Have a look at any keyboard. From the first row of letters to the one underneath, they're offset by, it turns out, a quarter of a key. But then, from the second row to the third row, they're offset by a full half a key. And that really threw me. And then I realized it's because of typewriters. They needed to have physical bars going up from each key, and those bars couldn't hit each other. So the top four rows, now including the letters, all have to be out of phase with each other. Let's fire this up. So when you're typing on a typewriter, it's a mechanical process. If I push down the M key, it's got to actually, a series of levers lift up this bar. And then that bar goes flying forward, stamp, M. So every single key has to have a physical bar going backwards to then actuate the lever that then does the typing. And those bars have to all be offset. And because there are four rows, you've got the numbers and then three rows of digits. The space bar is doing its own thing because it's just releasing it to click back. They are all offset by a quarter each. So from the numbers down to the row of letters, you're off by a half, and then you have a quarter, and then you have a half. And so you can see just at the top there, where all the bars are going back into the typewriter, they're all spaced like perfectly equally. And for some reason, that spacing, which was necessary for the mechanics, like the physical levers of a typewriter, is still present in our keyboards today. Oh, that is another relatable observation about everyday life. Let me just tweet that right now.
Hey, everyone.
Wait a minute. Once I understood the geometry, the offsets between the rows on the keyboard and the distances between the keys and between the rows, I could then just calculate the distance between every single pair of keys on the keyboard. I actually wrote some code to do it for every single pair as a vector. And I appreciate when you're typing, it's the same distance in either direction, but I was kind of future-proofing what I thought I might be doing next. And the distances between them, it's just the difference in the horizontal coordinates, the distance in the vertical coordinates, then use Pythagoras to get the, yeah, it's yet another example of using Pythagoras in everyday life. See? Your teachers knew what they were talking about. And so for every single pair of letters, I knew the distances between them. I then took a file that had 370,103 different English words apparently in it. I ran through every single word. I calculated the total distance your finger would have to travel if you were just doing the standard one finger moving around typing action. And I found the longest word. Our first problem, though, is we have to define what is a word, which is the kind of esoteric, high-class question that even for a math channel, I didn't think we would have to tackle. It's way classier than normal. Maybe if you do opening titles based on Murder, She Wrote, that's just the, you know, the quality that the channel tends towards. Serious discussion about what is a word. And it's not an easy discussion because of science and other technical academic areas of study, because they generate some outrageous words. The longest word in the data set I was using was actually the chemistry word dichloro, diphenyl, trichloro, ethane. I mean, personally, I would have collapsed the chloros, but I guess it's important to the chemistry structure or something. Actually, if I was going to shorten it, I'd just use DDT. This is the long version of DDT. And the crazy thing in chemistry is there's these kind of these algorithms for generating the names for very complex molecules. And if you follow them for some very big molecules, you'll generate some outrageously big words. Technically, single words. Technically, I guess, in English. But they're literally going to have thousands of letters. And I would say, from maths, you know, if I wanted to read a lot of big numbers out, it'd be like so many quadrillions, so many trillion, then billion. And we've also got algorithms to turn very long numbers into very long words. And so I guess the word for, like, you know, Graham's number or something. I mean, that would be an outrageously big, technically English word. So I'm going to remove, I don't think scientific words should count. There's also anti-disestablishmentarianism, which is famously like the longest word. But compared to DDT's 31 letters, it's only got 28, but it's still pretty good. I mean, it's long. And on the keyboard, if you were to type the whole dichloro, diphenyl, trichloro, ethane, you're gonna travel over 2 meters between all the keys. It's actually 212 centimeters for the full typing it out, whereas anti-disestablishmentarianism is just over 2 meters. It's like 203 centimeters. But it's also a technical academic word. In the end, I just ranked all 370 odd thousand words by the total travel distance and then read down to find the first one that I thought was arguably just a normal English word, and it is somewhat poetically super incomprehensibleness. 25 letters and a total travel distance of 167 centimeters. So there you are, the longest word in the English language is super incomprehensibleness. But Matt, I hear you say, words like super incomprehensibleness win just because they've got a lot of letters. So of course there's a lot of travel. What word is the longest on a per letter basis? And it turns out, well, technically it's pala pala. I think that's a Hawaiian word though, but it was in my data set. So who am I to argue? You average 13.9 centimeters per letter. I mean, it's a total of 111 centimeters. And that is pretty impressive. However, if you read down the list to the first word that I recognized as being a standard English word, it's papal, as in pertaining to the Pope. And papal is nice because it's lots of backwards and forwards. P-A-P-A-L. You're bouncing backwards and forwards across the keyboard and you're averaging 13.1 centimeters per journey. Some people might have been thinking Papa.
Papa!
Because Papa, you're like, well, hang on, P to A is a greater distance than A to L. Why would you put in that extra A to L? It's the weird fence post thing where the number of distances traveled is not strictly dependent on the number of letters, because you need a lead letter and then each one adds a new interval. Hello, Future Matt here. I'm in the edit and I realized me talking about the difference between papa and papal wasn't particularly clear in what I was just saying. What I was trying to point out is papa, each of these three gaps are the same. So P to A, A to P, P to A again. They are all 167.8 millimeters, which means if you've got three of them, it's a total travel distance of 503.3 millimeters, quite a way. Whereas papal has the same three gaps to start with, but then this extra one here is only 152.4 millimeters. And you might think, well, hang on, that's going to bring the average down. Why isn't papa the one with the longest distance on average? And it's because while papa has four letters and three gaps, when you go up to papal, the letters goes from four to five letters. That's an increase of plus 25% letters. And three gaps goes up to be four gaps. And that's an increase of about 33%. And this is what I meant. Actually, I think I was wrong when I said that they don't depend on each other. They do. It's just not linear. So the number of gaps has gone up by a different amount, 33% compared to 25% for the letters. And that's why papal is longer per letter. Because actually, even though 167 is a bit bigger than 152, they're about the same. And so this 33% is not a bad measure for how much the length has gone up, whereas the letters has gone up by a smaller amount. And so because the length's gone up by more than the letters, if you weight by letters, then papal is the longest on average. Whereas if I had weighted by gaps, then yeah, papa would be the best. But I picked, actually, I think I may have misspoken, I've swapped between them, but I picked, I want to do it based on letters, which is why papal wins. If you think papa is better, you can argue with me in the comments. And to be honest, later on when I get to angles, I switch to doing it the average amount per non-zero angle. So there you are, spoiler, that's coming up. Anyway, let's get back to papal. So actually, papal brings the average up a bit, 13.1 centimeters each. So there you are, that's your longest, I would say, standard English word weighted for the number of letters. Once I discovered this had now become a high class, like, wordplay fancy channel, I thought, well, I better keep going with this. Forget the longest words, what are the shortest words? That'll be fun, very intellectual. And obviously the shortest words are technically the ones where you don't have to move at all. It's like just the same letter over and over. Yeah, you're right. Technically four O's is a word. But I thought, if you're just typing the same key over and over again, I'm not gonna count those. Yeah, likewise, four M's doesn't count. So you got some very short two-letter words like as, A-S. Oh, and you always tend to stay within a row for shortest words because of the offsets, when you go up and down, you're in hypotenuse town, and that's slightly longer than going side to side. So A-S is a joint shortest two-letter word. S, A-S-S, less classy, but it is a joint shortest three-letter word up there with poo, P-O-O. Now, why isn't wordplay fun, kids? Shortest four-letter word, poop. P-O-O-P. So poo, you're only doing one movement of 19.05 centimeters. My camera person is not keeping a straight face for this. We're doing classy linguistics fun. Poop. Poop, unlike poo, double movement. You got P, you move 19.05 millimeters. O-O, back. Second movement. Sometimes I do get two movements from a poop.
Get out.
And that's 38.1 millimeters total travel. Shortest five-letter word, according to my data set, is D's. D-E-E-S-S. So this has got a bit of an up and down. So it's not D-E-E-Z, it's D-E-E-S-S. Apparently that's a word. I looked it up using the Google thing where you can search old books, and it's been used on and off for the past couple centuries. But I don't know what it means. The shortest word, where I do know what it means, is weeds. And that's actually quite fun to type, because it's like W-E-E-D-S. Nice little tight little circle. I really enjoyed typing that. And it's a bit classier, slightly classier. Weeds. None of this poo and poo-poo. Shortest six-letter word, wee-wee. Wee-wee. Total travel of 57.15 millimeters. And the shortest seven-letter word is wee-weed. So next time you wee-weed yourself, if you want to type that out and tell someone about it, you only have to travel 76.8 millimeters for, you know, wordplay. As well as the challenge to find the longest word in English, the keyboard warriors on Twitter were also replying with their own favorite words to type. And someone attempted the dismantlement of my argument that minimum is the maximum fun to type with their own suggestion of dismantlement, which is a fun word because it's from the words where you alternate sides of the keyboard. And as someone who types with the double hunt and peck approach, where, you know, each finger's kind of got a side, but the keys in the middle, they're like open game. Words that swap from one side to the other as you type them are a lot of fun. And I'm well aware people are judging me right now for my approach to typing. But frankly, I was able to type a number one best-selling book like this. I mean, not fast, but I typed it doing this. However, those sorts of words have already been very thoroughly investigated. Even before proper keyboards, back in we had a typewriter, people were looking up things like, what's the longest word you can type? All on the top row. And at 10 letters, typewriter is equal longest if you discount words like terror-proof. 11 letters. There you go. And actually, I'll link to some articles in other kind of recreational linguistic journals, which are, that community is very close to the recreational mathematics people, where they've looked at these sorts of alternating words. But I realized what I really liked about minimum is kind of the change of direction, like the angles when you're going backwards and forwards. And as far as I can tell, no one had looked into the angles that are formed when you type words. I thought, aha, it's my time to shine. And my goodness, was I ready for this challenge? I'd already stored the movement between any two keys as a vector. If I want to work out the angle in a three-key movement, I could use the dot product of those two vectors. Yes! It's an everyday practical application of the dot product. See? Your teachers were right when they said, make sure you learn your dot products, because one day, you'll be trying to calculate the angle traveled when typing, and the dot product's the way to do that because the dot product, simple to calculate. You just multiply the matching like coordinates or sections of the vector together, add it all up, and if you divide it by the two lengths of the vectors multiplied, which is another way to say you just normalize the vectors first, which is what I actually did in my code. I divided each vector by how long it was. What do you work that out? Using our friend Pythagoras. And if you do the dot product of those, you get the cosine of the angle between those vectors. So good. So now I just converted that back to an angle and I was in business. I took every single combination of three keys that you could hit in a row and I worked out the angle between them and then I ran that across all 370,103 words. And that's how I found out that SPA, SPA is the pointiest word in the English language. For average angle size. And here you've got to make some choices because actually fuzz comes in very close. So SPA has a smaller angle than fuzz because you start with the S, you go flying over to the P, you come flying back for the A. That's 0.8326 degrees, like an incredibly small angle. Whereas fuzz, the F to the U to the Z, that's 0.8714 degrees. That's a slightly bigger angle, but you've got two Z's on the end. So it's actually, if you get the total amount of angle traveled for the word, and then you weight it for number of letters, that's gonna beat SPA. I decided, I actually just care about the average angle size, in which case you are not gonna get a pointier word in the English language than SPA. That's why they're so relaxing. Technically, the smallest angle on the keyboard is either, it's a joint first, Anything involving Z, G, O, where you go from Z to O to G or vice versa, that's under half a degree, 0.49 degrees. Or if you move the whole thing across to the side, X, H, P, if you go from X to P and back to H or vice versa, that gives you equally smallest angle possible on the keyboard. And if you rearrange those, you get the biggest non-180 degree angle. So if you did Z to G to O, you're gonna have 178.986. So 179 degrees, crazy, like so close to 180. And it's because of this weird offset that we get these strange angles. And so I tried to find some words that contain those. And so it's they're weird words. You've got gazogene, which I think is a Victorian word for like carbonated water or something. Technically it's a word and it's got Z-O-G in it. You've also got schizogony. It's on the screen, you be the judge. Importantly, it's got a Z-O-G in the middle of it. So I think this, whatever this word is the word with the smallest angle in it somewhere. I think it's technically in the English language. I couldn't find a better one. If you want the word with the biggest non 180 degree angle, because people have already done ones that stay on the same row, like 180 has been done. I wanted to go the next one back, and it's Weyse goose. Weyse goose, apparently a real word. It used to be the name of an annual holiday that people in the printing industry would give their staff. That was such an important event that it got its own word, Weyse goose. But now it's used for different types of annual festivals. So they are Weyse goose. You've got your Z-G-O in that order in the middle, or Z-G-O if you're American. And that's 179 degrees. That's as big as it gets. So there you are. The word with the biggest angle in it is Weyse goose. As in, no Weyse goose has that got the biggest angle in it. And why not? I worked out the largest accumulative angle in a word, weighted for the number of letters. And if you include 180 degrees, it's outreach, because outreach starts flying 180s all the way across the top row, all in the same direction. And you chuck a UE, A-C-H. Oh, actually, really nice to type. So then I did the same thing, but no 180s. And now it's ethmoids. E-T-H-M-O-I-D-S. It's got like a backwards and forwards alpha kind of shape to it. And ethmoids, I guess it's an English word. The ethmoid is a bone. It's like a square-shaped bone in your nose or something. So I guess it's medical. I couldn't find a more common use word that was anywhere near as good as ethmoids. So let's say you collected those bones. You collected square-shaped bones from people's noses. Someone comes around and you're like, hey, check out my ethmoids. Using the word in the English language with the largest angle on average weighted for number of letters. And maybe working that out is the only hobby slightly weirder than collecting ethmoids. Then it occurred to me, looking at the difference between outreach curling around and ethmoids with its kind of crossing back on itself, I thought, well, maybe things that are fun to type are the ones where you're always turning in the same direction. And I can work that out using cross products. Yes! If you take the cross products of two vectors, you get another vector which is orthogonal to the first two, and the direction it goes in depends on if the other vectors are turning left or turning right. And already had the vectors, so I went through and calculated the cross product and checked the direction of it for every single set of three letters on a keyboard. So I now know for each set of three, if you're going straight forwards, you're coming straight back, you're turning left, you're turning right. I had every single option. And so I went through and found the longest words that consistently turn in the same direction. This interactive GeoGebra file was actually made for me by Sam Hartburn. I'll have a link to this in the description below if you want to check it out yourself. It's great. You can move the vectors around. You see the cross product change. Over here, you can see the vectors actually changing. What we've done, though, is we've pinned the last bit to be zero because the starting two vectors, we want to keep them in a flat plane. And then you see the cross product going up and down, and we actually don't care how big it is. So you can just turn on the unit version. There you are. We just care if it's up or down. Is it turning to the left, going up? Is it turning right, going down? That's all I needed to calculate which way things were turning. And you guessed it, here it is. It's the everyday practical application of the cross product. Your teachers are right, you will use them. One day you'll go, oh, I've got the vectors for the movements on the keyboard. If I add in 0 for the up and down dimension and then do the cross products, I can calculate if I'm turning left or right. Practical maths. Longest word with all left turns is non-mischievousness. And the non at the beginning is a bit of a cheat. You're just going forwards and backwards. I just didn't care about zeros and 180s. I figured it doesn't matter. As long as if you're turning, it's all the same. That word is in. And so non-mischievousness is all left turns, 18 letters. And all right turns, non, same little non at the beginning there, substitutionary, all right turns. Longest word with all right turns. So there you are, non-mischievousness and non-substitutionary are the words that have the most consistent turns. I don't know how this video got here either. By constantly turning in the same direction, I guess. So in conclusion, the word that is the most fun to type, mathematically speaking, on a keyboard, is still minimum. I've not found anything that beats that for pure joy. Fight me in the comments below. However, before we go, I want to get my laptop out to show you two things. One is the keys. So I love the fact that because on an old typewriter, the bars can't hit each other, it means if you look at the original four rows of keys, on these modern keys, just the OKs, right? The gaps between them, which are quite visible on a Mac keyboard, they never line up. I just find that so pleasing. And while I've got this out, I'm gonna mention today's sponsor, privateinternetaccess.com/standupmaths. The VPN I actually use and I'm paying for because I got a 2-year deal and paid up front before they asked me to do promos. Could be getting it for free. Anyway, so here's why I use privateinternetaccess.com/standupmaths. Let's say I wanna go to piratebay.com. Now, before I go, two things occur to me. Number one, better turn my VPN on. So let's just fire up the old private internet access and I can now choose what country I want to connect to. So here we go. Look at all these countries I can pick. Well, let's go in Italy. Why not? Let's go in, connect to Italy, streaming optimized. Why not? Hit connect. All my traffic now is being encrypted here. My internet service provider can't see what it is. It gets sent to, in this case, Italy. And I could pick from so many countries, and there it's decrypted. And I must admit, last time I did a promo, I was slightly wrong, where I was talking about how you can use the VPN to hide all of the URL when you're surfing the internet. It turns out if you're on a HTTPS website, it already hides all the URL after like the question mark. But your service provider can still see the domain, which is gonna be a problem. I'm going to piratebay.com because some websites like this can be blocked by different countries. For example, the UK. But if I turn it on, it doesn't know what I'm browsing and I could be in a different country. So I can access whatever sites I want. But I've also noticed that I've typed that wrong. So it's actually pi-ripbay. This is pi-ripbay. This is the mathematical website for downloading things. And there you are, real website, pi. Rip Bay for all your mass download needs. And my internet service provider has no idea I'm doing this. So as well as all the great things you get with a VPN and privateinternetaccess.com/standupmaths, super affordable. If you get the 3-year deal using my referral link, you're paying $2.08 a month because they give you an extra 2 months free. That's like 83% off. What a bargain. And as well as being able to connect loads of devices and you connect to servers in different countries, they are one of the few VPNs that are explicitly like built in to be able to use them for peer-to-peer sharing and torrents. So if you do want to go to the piratebay.com, privateinternetaccess.com/standupmaths, that's your choice. So there you are. Do check out that website. And if you want, pi-ratebay.com. I'm gonna warn you, did not spend a lot of time putting this together. And as a final thank you to all my Patreon supporters, here are your names as you've entered them into the Patreon system. I have then taken out anything that's not just a standard A through Z
alphabet letter. So no spaces, no punctuation, all of that gone, upper and lowercase is out the window. And I know this is no longer your name, and I know that other symbols are important, but I just wanted to calculate if you went between just the letter keys for all my Patreon supporters' names, which are the shortest, which are the longest. And so I've ranked them all here by length when typing those names. Good luck finding your own name, but they're all in there somewhere. So see if you can spot them. If you can't find them, I don't know, head over to the Patreon post for this video and I'll look them up. I've got the spreadsheet here. Yeah, I shouldn't share that. I think there's probably some privacy concerns with sharing. I mean, look at all these super identifiable names, and giving you the angles. That's just an extra free treat, just to say thank you for making these videos possible. I mean, I know VPN money, that gets me a long way, but that's not put on a stupid wig and run around my town of Godalming money. So, there you go. Oh, fun bonus fact. Every single shot in the opening titles, the Mathematics He Wrote titles, are within like a couple hundred meters of my office. Like, I just live in a village, you know? I'm surprised we don't have more murders. It's such an achingly English village. There you are. Thanks to all these people.